I'll present you work I've done on carbon and nitrogen metabolism in response to global change. I'll present two case studies. One, the first one I'll present is response to elevated CO2. And the second case study I'll present on elevated high soil temperature. So let's start. So carbon and nitrogen metabolism in response to elevated CO2. As you know, you have the, where's the speaker?
Oh, sorry, excuse me.
Oh, okay. Okay, you here? Okay, so in the last 400,000 years, we had the ups and downs in CO2, up to 300 parts per million in the atmosphere. But as you probably all know, since the Industrial Revolution in the 19th century, there is a big increase in CO2. This big increase in CO2 is a recording from the Mauna Loa. We see a recording from the beginning. Mauna Loa is in Hawaii, where they recorded since 1959 an increase of 17% from 316 parts per million to the current 370, which is already, I think the current is 380. So CO2 is increasing. As you can see here, we are here. This is an increase. In the green here, we have the different, this is from the IPCC panel of the UN on the increase of CO2. We have different models that model the what is the estimated increase in CO2 by the year 2100. The most optimistic one is 550 parts per million in the atmosphere. This is if everybody will do everything in order to decrease our CO2 emissions, and the pessimistic reach to 1,000 parts per million in the atmosphere. Plant responses to elevated CO2. The most common abundant protein on Earth is Rubisco. Rubisco, ribulose, bisphosphate, carboxylase, oxygenase. This is by far the most abundant protein ever on our planet. From its name, we learn that this Rubisco, which is, does all the work, has two. His main work is assimilating CO2, which we call photosynthesis. However, the same enzyme has an addition cycle, which actually competes with the CO2. It takes O2, and instead of assimilating CO2, it does photorespiration. Yes? This photorespiration is also correlated with photoassimilation of nitrate, and I will show it later. The problem is that this photorespiration was considered until now in many places as a wasteful process. Because if, when we grow plants under conditions where we don't have photorespiration, we have a 30% increase in yield. 30%. That's why there's lots of genetic work to try and diminish the photorespiration. However, everything, lots of billions of dollars were invested to it. However, everything failed. And the question is, if this process exists through evolution, may we think that it has a role, okay? And taking it off will increase sometimes yield in the short term for 30%, but what will it do? So the idea was to look at what is the role of photorespiration. So plant responses to elevated CO2. We know that in the short term, if you double CO2 from 360 to 720, you will increase photosynthesis by a rate of 30%. Okay? If you just double on the short term. However, when we have a long term, the stimulation of the elevated CO2 declines, and the yield increase will be only 12% in average. However, ecosystems in which nitrate is the predominant show complete decline. So where we have only nitrate in the soil, we'll elevate double the CO2, no increase in yield in the long term. This is called photosynthetic acclimation. Okay? However, in ecosystems where ammonium is predominant, like conifer ecosystems, where the soil is acidic, we show very little decline. So the yield increases. This is just from a meta-analysis of many works of other people. So what also happens when we elevate CO2? If we elevate CO2, yes, here CO2 is higher, so we have less photorespiration, right? And what we see is that also when in experiments, in phase experiments that were done all over the world, we see that when we have doubling of CO2, it produces a 14% decline in nitrogen content within the plant tissues. Okay? So from all these facts, which are facts that's taken from many researchers, we have a hypothesis that elevated CO2 inhibits nitrate assimilation. Okay? And I will show you this. Okay? So, nitrogen assimilation within the plant. Nitrate, I don't know, something happened to my arrows here, is reduced into nitrite, to ammonium, to glutamate. This is cytoplasm, stroma. This is the enzymes that are involved. This is the most important, energetically important, process within plants. Why? Because it consumes a lot of ATP. So much ATP that if we go backwards here in the process, you know what happens? Boom. All explosives today are designed on going backwards on this process. That's why if you check last night in the room, I saw CSI, they check for nitrogen on your fingers in order to see explosives. And this is all based on this. A very essential, important process that the plant invests in it a lot of energy. Okay, the biggest investment is in this process. Now, I'll go to a small complicated thing, but it will be short. This is the most complicated part of the talk. AQ. AQ we say assimilatory quotient. Okay, this is the quotient between CO2 consumption, when there's photosynthesis, there's CO2 consumption, and there's O2 is evolved, right? The opposite than respiration, right? So CO2 consumption, ratio from CO2 to O2 evolution. By theoretical, ideally it should be 1. It's never 1, okay? And this difference we call the AQ. Now I'll go a little bit more complicated. So we think that AQ is considered a non-destructive measure to measure nitrate assimilation within the plant. Because transfer of electrons from nitrate to nitrite increases O2 evolution from the light-dependent reactions of photosynthesis. So if we have an increase of this and no change in this, we'll have a change in the ratio. And plants that are also assimilating nitrate will exhibit a lower AQ, because this will be high, this will be stay, so the value will go lower. Now, this is the last one, delta AQ. If I feed plants with ammonium, they won't have nitrate assimilation, right? Because ammonium is next in the step, so they won't be assimilating nitrate. So I compare plants that are fed only with ammonium as the nitrogen source versus plants that are fed only with nitrate. Okay? When they are fed with nitrate, we have nitrate assimilation. I compare the AQ of these two plants, and this I call delta AQ. And delta AQ is proportional to nitrate photoassimilation, and I will prove it here and show it. Okay? Okay. Assessing AQ, how do we assess AQ? So we measure CO2 fluxes. CO2 fluxes are easy to measure. Infrared gas analyzer, the background, although there's an increase in CO2, it's only 380 parts per million. So to measure 1, 2, 5 parts per million on the background of 380 is easy, relatively. However, to measure the O2 fluxes, it's much harder. Because if the background of CO2 is 380 parts per million, the background of O2 is 210,000 parts per million in our atmosphere. So to measure 1, 2, 5 ppm is much harder. But today there's the option with advance of technology to measure both simultaneously. And building a very complicated instrument, we can measure these things. So what we did here, measure growing the model plant in Botany today. This was my first time I worked with Arabidopsis. This is Arabidopsis thaliana, grown in hydroponics. We look at three types of Arabidopsis. One is the wild type. One is an overexpressor that we got from Professor Yair Aymar. And one a nitrate reductase double mutant, where we don't have nitrate assimilation. Okay? Very low nitrate assimilation. So we compare these three. And what we do, first of all, just to show you that this is Arabidopsis in age, in days, and this is the nitrate reductase activity, the enzyme that is responsible for the first step of reduction from nitrate to nitrite. And you can see when the plant is young, we have relatively high nitrate reductase activity. When it's getting old, very low. Okay? The double mutant antisense we don't see because we can't detect it. And the overexpressor is here. Okay? Is higher. So we can see that we have young overexpressor and old. And we use the fact that old plants have very low nitrate reductase, nitrate assimilation actually, also in the experiment. So this is how the plant looks. These are the roots. We put this plant in a special chamber, and we measure O2 and CO2, okay, under either nitrate or ammonium, okay, fluxes. And what we get is a thing like this. This is, let's say, CO2 consumption, and this is light level. So we increase the light, we have more photosynthesis, okay? And this is under different conditions. What are the conditions? One condition is doubling the CO2, okay? And the second condition is decreasing the O2. If we decrease the O2, I'll show you soon the results, to 2%, we don't have photorespiration. So we decrease photorespiration by two methods, either increasing CO2 or lowering O2, okay? So you can see here, this, the top ones are 360 micromoles CO2 and 21 under ammonium and a nitrate, and we do all these, and we do both for CO2 and O2, and I won't go into details. What's important is, what is the delta AQ? You remember the first one, what I remind you? So here's delta AQ. Delta AQ, in this case, 360 ambient CO2 and elevated CO2. You could see that under elevated CO2, we don't have nitrate assimilation in this case, okay? However, on the young plant, under ambient, there is constant nitrate assimilation throughout the whole light level range, okay? To make sure this is really nitrate assimilation, what we do is compare what I showed you before to the double mutant. In the double mutant, both in ambient and elevated CO2, we have no nitrate assimilation. And also in all plants, we have no nitrate assimilation. And this is how it looks. This is the young. This is the old double overexpressor. What I show here is another line, the yellow one. Yellow here is in between the elevated CO2. And the ambient, and this is 2% O2, okay? This shows you that photorespiration also has a role in this delta AQ, okay? So our tentative conclusion is that delta AQ was significant only in shoots assimilating nitrate. Mutants without nitrate show no change. All the plants show no change. And nitrate reductase is not the limiting factor. No change in delta Q at elevated CO2, and only a small change at low O2. This indicates that these conditions inhibit nitrate assimilation. So the possible mechanism, as I said before, is photorespiration. Photorespiration limits reductant, and this may be a reason why billions of dollars were wasted, because people were trying to take this off photorespiration, but it is an important process. So this is the photorespiration, as I told you. So the biological function is not clear. This is the, how it looks biochemically. This is the chloroplast, mitochondria, and a peroxisome. And this is the way that the biochemical cycle of the photorespiration. The hypothesis, the mechanism, is that we think that this photorespiration stimulates a malate shuttle, and more reductant is available also in the cytoplasm. This is NADH is coming in the cytoplasm and helping us in the nitrate assimilation. The conclusions that nitrate assimilation and photorespiration, delta Q was validated as a measure. Elevated CO2 or decreased O2 inhibits shoot nitrate assimilation. And nitrate assimilation depends on photorespiration. Okay. What we did next, I won't show a lot of results. The question is, where is the signal more important, in the shoot or in the root? I'll just show you some things we do. We did micrografting in Arabidopsis. We do grafting. We take a transgenic and an overexpressor, and we graft them either root or shoot, or vice versa. And this is how it looks. You take a very dedicated student, and he creates this micrography. Just works a lot of hours. And this is when the adult one, OK? And what happens in other plants? So I won't show you a lot of things, but I'll just show you forests, what's a thing we did. So in California, the giant sequoia, OK? Although this is General Sherman, which is considered the largest tree in the world. And these are seedlings from seed. Okay, and we do the same thing that we did in Arabidopsis. We do it in also giant sequoia. And this is giant sequoia versus Arabidopsis. Okay, this is, it's called the redwood. I don't know if you know. You see, the stem here is really red when it's young. Okay, so we go to heat stress. Carbon and nitrogen metabolism in response to heat stress. The objective of this case study was to examine carbon and nitrogen metabolism under high soil temperature and its links to heat tolerance. Why plants are tolerant to heat? Okay, that's the idea. We went to geysers in Yellowstone National Park. They are very hot geysers. Okay? On the edges of the geysers, there's grasses growing, adapted for many years. We took the grasses. This grass from the Yellowstone is Agrostis cabra. And we took two other Agrostis species that are common, very common on golf courses. Okay? So we have three Agrostis species. Okay? This is considered very sensitive to high temperature. We grow them like this in sand. Okay? In sand, we grow them in order when we want to wash the roots, we want to minimize our destruction of the roots, okay? So either growing hydroponics or sand, okay? Our preferable always is hydroponics, but it's much harder in maintenance, and then we go sand. Cleaning soil, it's impossible to be non-destructive for the roots. This is how it looks. We grow the grasses in a bath, water bath, where we control the temperature in the water bath, and it's either growing under 20 degrees or under 37 degrees temperature. You can see that only the Yellowstone National Park grass looks good under the high temperature. Then we look at things like, which are considered as stress indicators. That's what I call it. FV over FM is a photochemical indicator that's common all over the world today, where 0.8 is considered non-stressed plants, and everything down below, especially below 0.7, is considered stressed plants. So you can see when plants are grown under 20 degrees, no significant stress. However, when we grow them under high temperature, this is the dotted lines, we could see for sure that the adapted plants from the Yellowstone show higher adaptation, non-stress resist. This could be seen also by visually. We could see that the membrane stability we measure also, this is a very easy measurement. We just look at electrolyte leakage from the tissues. We could see under 20 degrees, very low electrolyte leakage. However, under high temperature, the Yellowstone National plant has much less leakage, and this is due to lipid different construction. Completely different lipids. Well, I won't go into detail to that, but we have also data on that. This is relative growth rate, again. So all over, we see that our thermal agrostis cabra was tolerant to high soil. That's what we thought, but we had to look to be sure, OK? And we saw that the most sensitive was the pancreas. OK? So what happens to the carbon metabolism? OK? What happens to carbon metabolism? And I'm speaking as an economic view of the plant. How he budgets its carbon. OK? So how do we measure it? First, we have to measure photosynthesis. From the shoots, we measure photosynthesis. And we get, of course, this is photosynthesis. So if it's not full, it's high temperature. So under high temperature, there's a decrease in photosynthesis in all the species. But the decrease is almost insignificant in the Yellowstone National Park species, OK? This is time. And this is photosynthesis, so this is the Yellowstone National Park showing very little decrease, whereas the most sensitive has the biggest decrease in photosynthesis. What happened in the roots? So how do we look in the roots? So the first thing to do is putting the roots in hydroponics. That's what we did. We seal them, and we put here a septum, and here there is an air space, you see? And in this way, what we did, today I have a much more advanced machine, but in this time I didn't have it. Yeah, so what we do is we close the system for 60 minutes, and every 10 minutes we pull a sample, both for CO2 and for O2. Okay, what happens to the O2 when the roots are respiring? It's decreasing. So by 6 points in an hour, we could see a decrease, we could measure rate of respiration, and CO2 is increasing, we could measure nothing new. However, you see in the tolerant one, adapted one, the increase in respiration starts only after 3 weeks of high temperature, and it's very little, okay, as compared here. This is the sensitive. Look at the increase, almost tripling the respiration rate in the tripling. Meaning, if you increase the respiration, it says you are taking carbon to respiration instead to growth, okay? And this, the tolerant one, he's stressed, but he's not increasing his respiration. OK, we see it both in O2 and CO2. I won't go into this. And how do we measure the carbon budget? So first, is carbon can be allocated to 4 major processes. One is shoot growth. Second, root growth. Shoot respiration, root respiration. These 4 parameters are relatively easy to measure. And that's what we do. We measure these parameters. We measure total carbon, we measure relative growth rate, we measure photosynthesis and respiration. And this is how it looks. This is our economics of the, so this is the adapted one, Yellowstone grass. And these are the 2 others. So let's see. This is shoot growth. 32% of carbon is allocated to shoot growth. Okay, more or less 30% in all the species under 20 degrees. Under 20 degrees, there's no big difference. Although this one is adapted to high, it grows well under 20 degrees. What happens under high temperature? Let's see. This plant does not allocate anything to shoot growth. No carbon allocation to shoot growth. Because respiration in the roots is so high, he has to allocate all carbon to respiration. This one still allocates 17% to shoot growth. So it's half than what it was, but it's still half. It's still a big amount. what happens to nitrogen metabolism? So we do the same thing. We look at nitrogen, and we see that in nitrogen is around 65% to the shoots versus 35 under 20 degrees. However, under high temperature, there's still higher nitrogen allocation to the shoots in the Yellowstone National Park grass. So to summarize this, carbon allocation to growth at 37% soil decreased significantly, but carbon was allocated to respiration in the tolerant ones only after 28 days of exposure, and nitrogen allocation to roots increased at 37 degrees. The capacity to control carbon and nitrogen budget at high temperature was higher in the tolerant species. How do specific costs of respiration change? So respiration is, as I told you, it's a budget, okay? So, and it has different costs. So the rate of respiration depends on three major energy-requiring processes: maintenance, growth, and ion transport, where respiration equals maintenance respiration plus growth respirations plus ion uptake respiration. And this is not trivial to measure, but it's possible. How do we measure it? A plant has, within time, it has a different relative growth rate, okay? And this is root respiration. So you measure root respiration under different relative growth rates, okay? And it changes. When we have high relative growth rate, we have high respiration. Low relative growth rate, low respiration, because less respiration is allocated to this budget for the growth. So how do we measure maintenance respirations? In the point here where when we have zero, we do an extrapolation to the axis. When we have zero growth, the assumption is that all respiration goes to maintenance. Okay? So this is the maintenance respiration. And we can measure it easily. The slope is the growth plus the ion uptake cost. I just show you this result. Maintenance respiration in the tolerant one is low under 20 degrees. However, under high temperature, the increase is almost insignificant in the tolerant. It doesn't need a lot of more maintenance because it's adapted, as we saw, in the membranes and in other processes. Summarize, the capacity to control carbon and nitrogen budgets at high temperature was higher in the thermotolerant. Total root respiration increased under high temperature in all species. Maintenance respiration costs were lower under 20 degrees. Under high temperature, they increased by almost a lot. Okay? In a 97% increase in the sensitive one. The results indicate that carbon and nitrogen utilization in the tolerant ones were more efficient. Carbon and nitrogen utilization may play an important role in slow root growth and high root mortality. Heat tolerance of roots was related to the ability to control the respiratory costs. Okay? This is, I would like to thank all the people who helped me here: Bingo Huang, Hans Ambers, Arnold Bloom, Oren Schelef, Amir Eppel. I would like to show you, this is our place in Sde Boker. This is 10 minutes walk from us, our water spring. This is the snow we had 3 years ago. This is our institute, waterfall, where is the flood. We have some nice flowers. We have animals walking around us, people jumping, and thank you very much.